So the format of the vertical reading has been quite challenging, given that none of the 16 cantos are self-standing, but are emphatically and explicitly parts of diptychs or triptychs. For instance, like Inferno 15, Inferno 16 deals with sodomy and also initiates the episode of Geryon that will continue in the following canto. Purgatorio 16 is the first canto of a long and fundamental meditation on human agency and on the relationship of desire and reason, which continues in Purgatorio 17 and 18 and culminates with the dream of the siren in Purgatorio 19. And Paradiso 16 is the mid-canto of the Cacciaguida episode, in which the pilgrim encounters his ancestor and is told about both the good old days of ancient Florence and the exile awaiting him in the future. And as Denis Fachard writes, il canto sedicesimo ovviamente non sta a sé e quindi non può rivendicare una qualsiasi autonomia. And I think that this lack of autonomy is true for all the 16 cantos that I'm talking about today. That is to say, Inferno 16 is the final canto of a diptych, while Purgatorio 16 and Paradiso 16 are the first and middle cantos of their respective triptychs. Moreover, the 16 cantos are not only programmatically part of a larger group of cantos, but like all cantos of Dante's comedy, are closely related to the rest of the poem and to Dante's other works. So, for instance, cantos 15 and 16 of Inferno have been discussed together with canto 26 of Purgatorio, and here I can simply mention the very interesting and important papers by Bruce Holsinger, Gerrit Staro, Billboard Winkle, and very recently Heather Webb, which have all addressed and tried to explain the different treatment of sodomy and sexuality in Inferno and Purgatorio and the whole comedy. Second, the meditation on desire began in Purgatorio 16 is a theme that runs throughout the entire comedy and all of Dante's other works. And the relationship between papacy and empire at the center of Purgatorio 16 is not only a leitmotif of the whole poem, but also the very topic of Dante's Monarchia, the Latin treatise in political theory that Dante wrote while he was already working on the comedy. And finally, the theme of the city and Florence dealt with in Paradiso 16 begins to be addressed explicitly in the encounter with Chaco in Inferno 6 and is never abandoned for the rest of the poem. And here I want to mention at least the studies by John Ferrante, Catherine Keane, Claire Honess, and Simon Gilson. So the challenge of my vertical reading, which I'm sure I share with other speakers in the series here at Cambridge, lies precisely in the fact that these cantos deploy many themes and motifs that reach out not only to the rest of the poem, but also to Dante's other works and to medieval culture in general, not to mention various topics also related to our contemporary concerns. And yet, it has been striking to realize that the 16 cantos also share something significant, that is the nostalgia for a past irremediably lost that contrasts with the degeneracy of the present. My vertical reading today will focus on this nostalgia, although it will also contextualize it within the larger context of each of the 16 cantos, in the attempt thereby both to discuss the way in which it is specifically articulated in Inferno, Purgatorio and Paradiso, and to delineate a common discourse that, as we shall see, raises questions about the human agency and autonomy usually celebrated in the Divine Comedy, as well as about Dante's attitude towards politics and history. So in a way, I will try to offer a traditional reading that proceeds through the cantos, but rather than moving from Inferno to Purgatorio to Paradiso, I will begin with Inferno, jump to Paradiso, and conclude with Purgatorio. I like usually inverting a little bit. As I begin now with Inferno, I want to thank Simon Gilson for letting me read his lectura of Inferno 16 before its publication. I found it very interesting and helpful, and I will rely on it for several points that I will make. As I mentioned before, Canto 16 of Inferno is the second canto dedicated to the sinners of sodomy. Sodomy in Inferno is punished in the circle of violence, the seventh circle of hell, which is divided into violence against others, violence against the self, and violence against God. Sodomy, in particular, is classified with violence against God, which can be of three different kinds. Against God directly, blasphemy, against God's offspring, nature, sodomy, and against God's grandchild, art. And this is the sin of usury. As with the blasphemers and the usurers, the punishment of the sodomites also consists of being pelted with a rain of fire in a burning desert. But while the blasphemers lay supine on the fiery sands and the usurers are sitting, the sodomites run in continuous circles. The canto opens with three shades leaving their group and approaching Dante Pilgrim and Virgil in a way that immediately sets the dominant tone of the canto. Venian ver noi e ciascuna gridava, sostati tu, calabito ne sembri, essere alcun di nostra terra prava. Just as in Inferno 10, among the heretics, the Florentine Ghibelline leader Farinata degli Uberti had understood that Dante was from Florence thanks to his accent, so too now these shades recognize from Dante's dress that he and they all come from the same city, which they call Nostra Terra Prava, our degenerate land. This parallel between the encounter with Farinata in Inferno 10 and these lines at the start of Canto 16 anticipates the nature of the sinners that Dante will meet in the second part of the diptych. While in Canto 15 the sodomites encountered by Dante were mainly famous clerics and men of letters, cerci e literati di gran fama, including Dante's own mentor or teacher, Donato Latini, Canto 16 is populated with civic and military leaders who were active in Florence around the mid-13th century, albeit, in this case, the shades are Guelphs and not Ghibellines, like Farinata. Virgil shows great respect towards these shades and even urges the pilgrim to be courteous towards them. Ora aspetta, disse, a costor si vuol essere cortese, e se non fosse il fuoco che saetta la natura del loco, gli dicerei che meglio stessi a te che a lor la fretta. When the running shades come nearer to the pilgrim, one of them addresses him in a very elaborate tone and with a great display of rhetorical skills. Qual sogliono i campioni far nudi e unti, avvisando lor presa e lor vantaggio, prima che siano tra lor battuti e punti, così rotando, ciascuno il disagio brizzava a me, sì che incontrarlo il collo faceva i piedi continuo viaggio. E se miseria desto loco sollo rende in dispetto noi e nostri prieghi, cominciò l'uno, e il tinto aspetto e brollo, la fama nostra, il tuo animo pieghi, a dirne chi tu sei, che vivi piedi così sicuro per l'inferno freghi. Some critics have noticed that the comparison with the naked bodies of wrestlers carries an erotic overtone, something which was already present in the previous canto's encounter with Brunetto Latini. And another aspect that this canto shares with the previous canto is a particular obsession with fame. The shade, who addresses now Dante, reveals that the group is indeed formed of three Florentine Guelph leaders, all of whom had died by 1272, and who were renowned for their patriotic deeds in Dante's youth. These three figures are Guido Guerra, Teghiaio Aldobrandi, and Jacopo Rusticucci, the speaker. In this moment, we realize that two of these souls belonged to the groups of past Florentine leaders about whose place in the afterlife the pilgrim had inquired when he had encountered the Florentine Ciacco in Inferno 6. Ciacco, there, had told the pilgrim that all these souls were in hell. Nonetheless, the respect shown by Virgil towards the Florentine sodomites corresponds to the admiration shown for them by the pilgrim in Inferno 6 and to the esteem that they enjoyed in the time of Dante's youth. Indeed, the pilgrim's reaction on meeting these shades is still one of great admiration. Se io fossi stato dal fuoco coperto, gittato mi sarei tra lor di sotto e credo che il dottor l'avria sofferto. Ma perché io mi sarei bruciato e cotto, vinse paura la buona voglia che di loro abbracciar mi faceva ghiotto. Some critics have rightly argued and shown that the pilgrim's attraction is also erotic, and I certainly agree that sexual overtones of same-sex attraction are present in both these and the previous canto. But what interests us now is that the pilgrim confirms that he does indeed also come from Florence. Di vostra terra sono, e sempre mai l'ovra di voi e gli onorati nomi con affezione ritrassi e ascoltai. Lascio lo fele e vo per dolci pomi promessi a me per lo verace duca, ma infino al cento pria conviene ch'io torni. The shades do not show any sign of interest in the pilgrim's journey of salvation from hell to heaven, but continue to rely on fame and to care only for reports of Florence. And this interest merely in the affairs of this world is something that they share not only with Brunetto, but also with Farinata. In particular, they want to know if cortesia e valor, courtesy and valor, are still present in their city, because the soul of a certain Guglielmo Borsiere recently arrived in hell and brought them worrisome news. Se lungamente l'anima conduca alle membra tua, rispose quelli ancora, e se la fama tua dopo te luca, cortesia e valor di se dimora nella nostra città sì come suole, o se del tutto se ne gita fora, che Guglielmo Borsiere, il qual si dole con noi per poco, e varrà coi compagni, assai ne cruccia con le sue parole. As Gilson explains, cortesia e valore are terms expressing not just societal values and elegant behavior, but a complex knot of ethical values linked to moral dignity, chivalric courtliness, nobility, and above all, measure and order. With a violent reaction recalling that of a prophet of the Old Testament, the pilgrim angrily confirms that courtesy and valor have indeed disappeared from Florence, replaced now by the excess and arrogance, orgoglio and dismisura, that have been created by a new social class and its economic interests. So this is how the pilgrim reacts to the question whether courtesy and valor are still alive in Florence. La gente nuova e i subiti guadagni, orgoglio e dismisura ingenerata, Fiorenza in te, sì che tu già ten piani. Così gridai con la faccia levata, e i tre, che ciò intese per risposta, guardar l'un l'altro come al ver si guata. Dante's words and attitude highlight the contrast between the virtue of the past and the vice of the present, and as Lino Pertile has explained, related to a historical phenomenon of an economic, social and cultural nature. The phrase gente nuova e i subiti guadagni indicates people who moved from Florence from the countryside and through commerce and finance made fast fortune, opening up the closeness and static character of a previous feudal system towards the beginning of capitalism. Dante's words recall not only Brunetto's and Chacco's critique of Florence's greed, envy and pride, but also a passage from the Convivio on the devastating effects upon the city community brought about by the accumulation of wealth which creates a virtuous circle whereby greed, cupiditate, can never end but only continually increase to the extent that canon law and civil law aim precisely at managing and controlling it. And this is the passage from the Convivio. E che altro quotidianamente pericola e uccide le cittadi, le contrade, le singolari persone, tanto quanto lo nuovo raunamento d'avere a qualcuno? Lo quale raunamento nuovi desideri discopre, allo fine degli quali senza ingiuria ad alcuno venire non si può. E che altro intende dimenticare l'una e l'altra ragione, canonica dico e civile, tanto quanto a riparare alla cupiditate che, raunando ricchezze, cresce? So I will return to the connection between greed and the law. But for the moment, I just want to say that after the Sodomites depart, urging the pilgrim to speak about them on earth, and thereby confirming again their obsession with fame, The final part of this canto is concerned with the preparation of, for the arrival of Geryon. And, you know, as we were discussing in the workshop just before, like the arrival of Geryon is a very important metapoetic episode, where, for instance, the term comedia is mentioned for the first time as the title of the poem. But I will not discuss it here. Here, I just want to conclude by stressing, conclude my sort of short overview of Canto 16, by stressing the ambivalence with which Inferno 16 portrays the Florentine sodomites and the Florence of their time. Despite the fact that, as Chacco had mentioned in Inferno 6, these are souls indeed in hell, and like Brunetto, only seem concerned with the mundane sphere of earthly values, and despite the parallel with Farinata, which exposes the fatal blindness of the Florentine aristocracy in its attachment to party and family at the expense of broader loyalty to city and patria, in spite of all these, Canto 16 of Inferno emphasizes a contrast between Florence's negative presence of orgoglio e dismisura and the positive valore e cortesia which characterized the past during which these Florentine sodomites lived. Moving now to Paradiso 16 will give us a different perspective and reveal that the past presented as ambivalent in Inferno 16 was actually pretty bad itself, and that the contrast set up in the Commedia between a bad present and a good past is more accurately a contrast between a very bad present, a less bad recent past, and a good distant past. So, like, if now we move to Paradiso 16, as I mentioned before, this canto is the mid part of a triptych staging Dante's encounter with his ancestor Cacciavida, which is one of the most significant and justly famous episodes of the whole poem. It opens with the pilgrim's vanity and pride for his ancestor's decision to follow the Emperor Conrad III in the Second Crusade, and thus finding death as a martyr while fighting for the church. The pilgrim's pride is signaled by his switch to the void form, to the formal form, while asking for more information about the Florence of the good old days, which Cacciaguida had nostalgically celebrated in the previous canto, in a way, in a very long way, that can be summarized by the famous terset with which the lengthy passage of praise begins. So this is how, you know, in Inferno 15, the previous canto, Cacciaguida had begun to sort of celebrate nostalgically the Florence of the good old days. Fiorenza, dentro della cerchia antica, ond'ella toglie ancora e terza e nona, si stava in pace, sopra e pudica. Sorry, I'm smiling because I find Cacciaguida's Florence the most boring place ever. A small city contained within the small circle of its ancient walls, peaceful, temperate, and modest, exactly the opposite of the depictions of contemporary Florence throughout the poem, especially by Chacco in Inferno 6 and Brunetto in Inferno 15. As critics have acknowledged, Cacciaguida's nostalgic description of Florence, of the good old days, is meant to emphasize a contrast between past and present. But, and this is one of the main points that I want to make now, it is a different past from the one mentioned in Inferno 16 and nostalgically recalled there by the Florentine sodomites. In other words, the Commedia stages three different Florences. First, and this is what I was mentioning before, first, the peaceful and fully positive Florence of the remote past described by Cacciaguida. Fiorenza dentro dalla cerchia antica, the late 12th and early 13th century. Second, the Florence of the recent past, referred to by the Florentine sodomites, a period presented ambivalently in Inferno 16, but which was in reality factional and already very bad. And this is around the mid-13th century. And third, the purely negative Florence of the present, the late 13th century. After his ancestors' praise of this remote Florence in Canto 15 of Paradiso, in Canto 16, our canto, the pilgrim wants to know more detail, wants to know more details about his ancestor and the Edenic Florence of the past that he has been celebrating. In particular, he wants to know how big its populace was and which were the most important families. Quanto era allora e chi erano le genti tra esso degne di più alti scanni. In a language that is not questa moderna favela, and it has been long debated whether this is Latin, with which Cacciaguida had begun to speak in Canto 15, or, as it seems more likely, the old dialect of Florence, anyway, in some other language than the contemporary one, Cacciaguida first gives some more details about his family, and then moves on to speak about his Florence, which is what interests us here. The first piece of information that Cacciaguida gives is that in his time, the number of citizens was 1/5 of those who live there now, confirming thereby the small size and containment of ancient Florence. But the main difference between the Florence of his past and that of the present, Cacciaguida adds, is that the former was pure down to the last artisan, while the latter is mixed with people coming from the countryside. And the contrast we see is between pura and mista. Ma la cittadinanza, che or mista di campi, di certaldo e di feghine, pura vediasi nell'ultimo artista. O quanto fora meglio esser vicine quelle genti che io dico e al Galluzzo e a Trespiano aver vostro confine, che averle dentro a sostener lo puzzo del villan da Guglion di quel di Segna che già per barattare all'occhio aguzzo. The contrast between the purity, which is also like a term that sort of bothers me, but anyway, the contrast between the purity of Florence citizenry in the ancient past, pura, and its contamination in the present, mista, recalls Inferno XVI's contrast between la gente nuova e i subiti guadagni of contemporary Florence and the valore cortesia of the previous generation. And the contrast is highlighted here by the emphasis on the stench, puzzo, that this contamination produces and that is here represented by two political figures associated with corruption and barbarity and connected in a way or another with Dante's exile. And so they are Baldo da Guglione and Fazio dei Moraguldini da Segna, the two guys that are mentioned down there. So after this opening, Cacciaguida hints at the fact that the destructive movement of people from the countryside into the city and the subsequent societal contamination and corruption is but another consequence of the church's damaging opposition to the emperor's control over Italy. This opposition between the church and the empire has meant that several lords, no longer protected by the emperor, have been forced to give their castles and territories to the communes and have moved to Florence. And some people have actually thought that there is a very specific reference to the 1197 Treaty of San Genesio, with which the Tuscan cities decided not to recognize the authority of anyone governing on behalf of the emperor unless he has also been approved by the Roman Church. So basically, it's the church politics against the empire that has forced the lords to give up their castles, creating all this mess that then has pushed people from the countryside into the city, creating the contamination that creates the puzzo, the stench of contemporary Florence. And the fault of all of that is the church's fighting against Cesare, against the Empire. Se la gente che al mondo più traligna non fosse stata a Cesare Noverca, ma come madre a suo figlio Benigna, tal fatto è fiorentino e cambia e merca che si sarebbe volto a Sinifonti, là dove andava l'avolo alla cerca. Sariasi Montemurlo ancor dei conti, serriano i cerchi nel piover d'Acone e forse in Val di Greve, in Mont del Monte. All these family who are now in Florence, they would still be part of the countryside. Ultimately, Cacciaguida insists, it is the resultant intermingling of persons, confusion delle persone, that caused the city's growth and subsequent decay. Sempre la confusion delle persone principio fu del male della città. As Justin Steinberg has recently outlined in his book Dante and the Limits of the Law, critics have debated and disagreed about Dante's political statements in Cacciaguida's cantos, especially about Dante's attitudes towards the guild-based government of the popolo and its mercantile values, social mobility and new wealth. A focal point in this debate has been the question of the extent to which the Commedia completely rejects the guild-based system and instead offers an idealized version of feudal aristocracy, or whether, on the other hand, and despite its imperial convictions, Dante continues to be attached to the populist critique of the nobility's excessive corruption, consumption, and factionalism. So I would agree with this latter point, which is made by John Nagemi, but what I want to mention here is that while Dante's insistence on the positive purity of old Florence versus the negative intermingling of the more contemporary one is both puzzling and distressing, Catherine Keane and Steinberg have sort of like turned this distressing emphasis on contamination and tried to sort of like justify it in another way. And they have argued, respectively, that Cacciaguida's critique of immigration is to be understood as an attack against a materialistic attitude towards civic life that is exploitative rather than contributory and brings corruption to the old, simple order. This is Keane. And Steinberg argues that Cacciaguida's attack on Sylvan citizens is only incidentally concerned with their mercantile upstart nature, and that rather than a particular class, Cacciaguida rejects a political juridical phenomenon in which citizenship is treated purely as a private contract in a way that harms the principle of shared obligations and responsibility. So this was a way to redeem this emphasis on the stench that the contamination produces. Change may not always be good, but it is inevitable. And the second part of the canto introduces this new theme, that of the necessity of mutability, firstly of human affairs in general, and then of Florentine families in particular. So the second part of Cacciaguida's talk in Inferno 16 switched toward the inevitability of change. So change has taken place, and change is inevitable. Augustine, there. Le vostre cose tutte hanno lor morte, sì come voi, ma celasi in alcuna che dura molto e le vite son corte. E come il volger del cielo, della luna, cuopre e discuopre i liti senza posa, così fa di Fiorenza la fortuna, perché non dei parer mirabil cosa ciò che io dirò degli altri fiorentini, onde è la fama nel tempo nascosa. I find it interesting that, unlike the Florentine sodomites and other Florentines mentioned in Hell, those good ones mentioned by Cacciaguida were not famous at Dante's time. In particular, Cacciaguida gives a lot of details about several notable Florentine families from his time, mentioning first those which had been important but were already losing their importance, then those which were at the height of their power, and finally those which were not powerful yet, but were about to begin to gain significance and power. And for those of you who are familiar with the canto, there is this sort of like excruciating lists that sort of like exemplify the mutability of human affairs. It is a long section running from like 87 to 147, which exemplifies the natural alternation of human vicissitudes and concludes by mentioning the episode that was traditionally considered to be the origin to the fight between Guelphs and Ghibellines, that is, the murder of Buontelmonte, the Buontelmonti, in 1215. Finally, in the third and last part of Cacciaguida's speech, Cacciaguida ends his long speech by making it clear that Florence's good old times belong to the remote past of his youth, and that the period of civic strife between Guelphs and Ghibellines, which was associated with a time of valore cortesia by the sodomites in Inferno 15, 16 was actually already a negative moment in Florence history. So at this point, it is also made clear that what was nostalgically missed in Italian 16 was actually better. And sort of like ambivalently presented in Inferno 16 was actually not so good. Con queste genti e con altre con esse, vidio Fiorenza in si fatto riposo che non avea cagion onde piangesse. Con queste genti vidio glorioso e giusto il popol suo, tanto che il giglio non era ad asta mai posto a ritroso, né per divisione fatto per nino. So, the symbol of Florence really had not been tainted by the civic strife between Guelphs and Ghibellines. So, if it is now clear that a contrast also exists between the distant, peaceful Florence of Cacciaguida and the violent and factional one of the Florentine sodomites, one can also begin to ponder what kind of violence was associated with their sin of sodomy, because after all, sodomy was a sin, is a sin of violence. So like, I will return to this at the end, but for now, there is something else that I would like to highlight. That is, that Canto 16 of Paradiso seems to create an ambivalence or tension between a sense of inevitable change compared to the natural cycle of life and death, like that of the Florentine families of the past, and a sense of vertical degeneracy and decline into violence, connected rather with human responsibility, as in the case of the decline from the Florence of Cacciaguida's good old days to the period of fighting between Guelphs and Ghibellines, and finally to the degeneracy of Dante Sforza on time. So like, I think that there is a sort of like tension in Cacciaguida's speech between a sort of like cyclical sense of alternation of human vicissitudes and this sort of like vertical degeneration of politics. So Purgatorio 16, to which I will now move, will help us, I hope, to deal precisely with this crucial question. So like, if now I move to the last canto of my talk, Purgatorio 16, this is literally the center of the poem. And here Dante deals with the very ethical foundations of his Beltanciano, human agency, that is, human agency and responsibility. The canto is set in the third terrace of Purgatory, where, as usual in Purgatory, pain works productively as therapy. And in this case, wrath is cured. The purging shades, as well as the pilgrim and Virgil, are forced to experience a very thick smoke that does not allow them to see anything. And the first part of the canto insists on the productivity of this experience of pain. When a purging, I won't linger it, but for me, I have always, for a long time, been interested on what I call productive pain, and you know, to reread this initial part was also like very interesting, but I will sort of leave it and move to when a purging soul reveals his identity to the pilgrim, and he does so by mentioning the same valor, which together with cortesia was discussed in Inferno 16 as something belonging to the past, and therefore introducing again this sense of nostalgia between a present, a good present and a bad past. This soul simultaneously confirms that indeed it is a virtue that no longer is practiced by humankind. Valore. I says, Lombardo fui e fu chiamato Marco, del mondo seppi, e quel valore amai al quale ciascun disteso l'arco. That valor is not practiced anymore by anybody. Little is known of Marco Lombardo, who seems to have been a refined courtier operating in several northern Italian courts. Marco's statements on the disappearance of Valor remind the pilgrim, this is quite complicated, but I hope you will follow me, because Marco's statements on the disappearance of Valor remind the pilgrim of what another soul had told him while he was on the terrace of Envy. That previous soul spoke in Purgatorio 14, two cantos before, about the corruption spreading through the valley of the river Arno in Romagna, where the glorious past and the values of its noble families contrast with the degenerate situation of the present. After listening to Marco, the pilgrim wants to know the reasons why virtue has disappeared from Earth. So he now wants, finally, is addressing the reasons why things have changed so dramatically. Lo mondo è ben così tutto deserto d'ogni virtute, come tu mi suoni, e di malizia gravido e coperto. Ma priego che m'addite la cagione, si chi la veggia e chi la mostri altrui, che nel cielo uno e uno qua giù la pone. Thus, like the 16th cantos of Inferno and Paradiso, also the 16th canto of Purgatorio establishes a contrast between the good past and the bad present, although here the current degeneracy pertains not only to Florence, but to the whole world. Lo mondo è ben così tutto deserto, d'ogni virtute. But what this canto adds to this meditation about the contrast between the past and the present is the explicit question about the reason, la cagione, for current corruption. In particular, the pilgrim asks whether it has to be attributed to a deterministic influence of the stars on men, nel cielo, or to men's agency and will, qua giù. And this is where I was seeing the same sort of like reference to what in Cacciaguida's speech was a tension between a cyclical course of things that is natural and a vertical degeneration. Clearly, this is no more small question, and its full significance is unfolded in Marco's reply, so that the reader cannot miss what is at stake. So like here, Marco is really very didactic. This is very important. First, Marco explains that it is absurd to think, as humans do, that the reason for everything has to be attributed to the influence of the stars, because this would mean that humans have no free will, and therefore there would be no justice in being punished for doing evil or rewarded for being good, for doing good. Frate, lo mondo è cieco, e tu vieni ben da lui. Sort of this condescending opening towards the pilgrim's naivete to ask such an absurd question. Voi che vivete, ogni cagione recate pur suso al cielo, pur come se tutto muovesse seco di necessitate. Se così fosse, in voi fora distrutto libero arbitrio, e non fora giustizia per ben letizia e per male aver lutto. As a passage of the Monarchia indicates, following Boethius, free will, liberum arbitrium, is free judgment in matters of volition, liberum de voluntate judicium. Judgment is the link between perception and application. For first a thing is perceived, then it is judged to be good or evil, and finally the person who judges pulses it or shuns it. Now, if judgment controls desire completely and is in no way preempted by it, it is free. But if judgment is in any way at all preempted and thus controlled by desire, it cannot be free, because it does not act under its own power, but is dragged along in the power of something else. Along similar lines, Marco Lombardo continues, it is true that the stars can have a certain influence on human inclinations and desires, but men are always endowed with the light of reason and with a free will that, if they are well nurtured, can overcome all inclinations emanating from the stars. Lo cielo, i vostri movimenti inizia, non dico tutti, ma posto che io dica, lume vedato a bene e a malizia e libero voler, che, se fatica nelle prime battaglie, col ciel dura, poi vince tutto, se ben si notrica. Here I would like to highlight the if clause, se ben si notrica, which I read as implying that a certain training is necessary for men to be able to exert free will over the inclinations coming from the stars. But for the moment, Marco attributes all influence to men's freedom, which is based on the human faculty to control one's appetites and consists, no, sorry, I got the, it's important. For the moment, I mean, there is this if clause that sort of like seems to complicate things, but for the moment, Marco attributes all inference to man's freedom, which is based on human faculty to control one's appetites and consists of aligning one's desires with the soul's innate love for God and what is good. Okay, so like, this is this sort of like emphatical stress on freedom that is connected to mente, to the rational faculties of the soul. A maggior forza e a miglior natura liberi soggiacete, e quella cria la mente in voi che il ciel non ha in sua cura. Però, se il mondo presente disvia, in voi è la cagione, in voi si cheggia, e io te ne sarò or vera spia. Men can freely subject themselves to God, who is a greater force and a better nature than the stars. And the reason for this freedom is that the rational soul, la mente, is completely unaffected by any celestial influence. And this is precisely why men, not the heavens, are always responsible for their actions. Human autonomy from the stars' impact and any other sort of external power is related to the way in which the rational part of the human soul was understood by Dante to be not generated, as in the case of the vegetative and sensitive faculties, but created individually and directed by God. And this is something that really Statius explains very clearly in Purgatorio 25, the distinction between some parts of the soul that are induced from matter and generated, up to the vegetative and sensitive soul, and then the rational faculty that is created, directed by God, and therefore completely free from any external influence. So this is explained by Statius in a very scholastic way in Purgatorio 25. It is also explained by Virgil in Purgatorio 18, two cantos afterwards, and there he speaks about innata libertate, the soul's innate freedom, in a passage that I really see as the moment where Dante is finally confronting Cavalcanti's Donna Me Prega in scholastic terms. He had already tried to do so in the Vita Nuova, but the Vita Nuova was moving into a sort of like lyric universe, and you know, Dante had not the possibility, had not the means, had not the philosophy to be able to really confront Cavalcanti in his own scholastic terms. He does so in Purgatorio 25 and in Purgatorio 18. Okay, but as an example of this, or the reason of the soul being free because it is created by God, I want to mention another passage which is also created, connected to embryology, which is Paradiso 7. Where Beatrice beautifully and elegantly restates the fact that the soul, the rational soul, la mente, is coming from God and therefore it is free. L'anima d'ogni bruto e delle piante di complession potenziata tira lo raggio e il moto delle luci sante. And you see, it's because there is this complession potenziata that makes the sensitive and the vegetative part of the soul as liable to be affected by the stars. Ma, and this is the case of humans, ma, vostra vita, senza mezzo, spira. It is breathed, it is created directly, senza mezzo, by God, la somma benignanza, e la innamora di sé, che poi sempre la desira. In the past, I have worked really quite intensively on medieval embryology, and I still find it fascinating. But fortunately for you, time does not allow me to go into the details here. If you want, we can talk about it later. What matters is that despite, you know, like, so far we have seen this emphasis on human full freedom, and it is also connected and explained with the fact that the rational soul is created directly by God. Marco is very clear. Humans are fully responsible for what they do and for what they choose, for what they choose. But what I find interesting is that despite the emphasis placed by the poem on the rational soul's ultimate autonomy from the star's influence, Marco's subsequent explanation of the reason for the world's current corruption takes another track and begins by stressing not that the soul can resist celestial affects, but rather that it can easily go astray and therefore requires a guide. So there is really like a change of emphasis, which I also like find refreshing, because another thing that bothers me is in the Commedia precisely this constant, or not constant, but pretty major emphasis on the autonomy of the subject. Here it seems to be questioned. This is Marco Lombardo continuing his speech. Again, with a reference to the embryology. Here it's the rational soul which is created by God, but then he moves not towards freedom, but towards the possibility to make mistakes. Esce di mano, and this is really beautiful, the image of the little soul moving around like a child is really delightful. Esce di mano a lui che la vagheggia, prima che sia, a guisa di fanciulla che piangendo e ridendo pargoleggia l'anima semplicetta che sa nulla, salvo che, mossa da lieto fattore, volentier torna a ciò che la trastulla. Di picciol bene in pria sente sapore, qui vi si inganna e dietro adesso corre, seguire o freni, non torce suo amore. Each soul is created individually by God and behaves like a child who knows nothing, but as it originates from a joyous maker, is simply attracted to what pleases it. The soul, therefore, turns to whatever delights it without pondering whether it is the right or wrong choice, and unless it has a guide or a curb that controls its desire, seguida o friend non torce suo amore, it loses its way. Critics have noticed that a similar concept had already been expressed in Book 4 of the Convivio, which states that the soul's supreme desire is to go back to God, who is its first cause. This is a very famous passage. Parolin considers it, because I don't think that I have it on my handout. I don't have the English translation, so I will read the Convivio in Italian. But it says, lo sommo desiderio di ciascuna cosa e prima dalla natura dato è lo ritornare allo suo principio. E però che Dio è principio delle nostre anime e fattore di quelle simili a sé, siccome è scritto facciamo l'uomo ad immagine e somiglianza nostra, essa anima massimamente desira ritornare a quello. So it's a passage where, which begins by stressing how the supreme desire, the greatest desire that each thing has is to go back to its beginning, and that therefore the soul, whose beginning is God, because it is created by God, desire mostly to go back to it. And yet, as the passage from Convivio goes on to say, the soul's knowledge is imperfect, and it can therefore let itself become attracted by the lesser goods and choose the wrong path. Rather than attaining its goal and reaching the satisfaction of its supreme desire, the soul ends up being consumed by a desire that is never fulfilled, but constantly increases and endlessly pushes it towards ever greater possession. So, if we go back to Marco Lombardo's speech in Purgatorio 16, this tendency to go astray makes it necessary for humankind to have a guide or a curb that can help it to control its desires in a proper way. That's what I was saying. Like, at first it tastes the savor of a trifling good, it is beguiled by that and follows in pursuit, if guide or rein, to not deflect its love. Seguido fren, non torce, suo amore. Marco Lombardo's connection between the soul's liability to lose its way from the right path and its need for a guide recalls a passage in the Monarchia in which humankind's need for guidance is justified on the basis of Augustine's concept that after the fall and original sin, the human condition is tainted with cupiditas, with cupidity. If man had remained in the state of innocence in which he was created by God, he would have had no need of such guidance. Such powers are vast remedies for the infirmity of sin. In a similar way, Marco concludes that a king is necessary for humankind to see at least the tower of the true city. Onde convenne legge per frem porre, convenne rege aver che discernesse della vera cittade almen la torre. So what seems to be implied is the same idea that this necessity, this possibility to go astray, is connected with original sin, and this is why it is necessary to have both an emperor and a pope. So in a similar, Marco Lombardo's speech, okay, onde convenne legge per frem porre, convenne rege aver che discernesse della vera cittade almen la torre. Marco Lombardo's speech takes a political turn and maintains that precisely because of man's post-lapsarian fallibility, it was necessary to set laws as a curb, frame, and to have an emperor, rege, as a guide. As Charles Singleton explains, the image transposes convivious notion of the soul guided by reason in its pilgrimage in this life to that of mankind collectively engaged in a pilgrimage. The goal or city for mankind collectively, here I'm quoting Singleton, and following Dante's idea as set forth in the Monarchia, is universal justice, which under the perfect rule of the monarch should prevail and is synonymous with temporal felicity, the goal to which the emperor is ordained to lead. So it is necessary in this case, Marco is speaking about the emperor in this case, but you know, because Dante is interested in politics, and his idea is that it's necessary to have a rege that can guide humankind. According to Marco, the current problem is that if it is true that laws have been set and do exist, they are not enforced for the reason that the throne of the empire is empty, and the Pope, rather than offering spiritual guidance to humankind, wants to have temporal and mundane power and ends up offering a negative influence. And this is something that, you know, Heather and I have worked on, have explored in a dialogue with René Girard's mimetic theory. So laws exist. The problem is not that laws do not exist. Laws exist. The problem is that they are not respected because there is not a powerful emperor. And the reason why an emperor is not existing is because of the church's power. We go back to what I had hinted at with Caccialvita. Le leggi son, ma chi pon mano ad esse? Nullo, però che il pastor che procede rugumar può, ma non ha lunghe feste. Perché la gente che sua guida vede pur a quel ben fedire onde è ghiotta, di quel si pace e più oltre non chiede. The same image of the emperor as the guide who is meant to curb humankind but is actually absent is also present in the very famous passage of the sort of tirade of Purgatorio 6 and also in Convivio 4. It is a very interesting image, that of the curb, that, as Elena Lombardi has argued, suggests that reason is like a horseman that must govern passion like a horse, and that therefore the image of the curb does not convey the necessity of extinguishing desire, but rather hints at its taming and suggests the usefulness of passion. If well directed and correctly spurred, desire may become a useful and faithful carrier of the self. And this is really something that, you know, like, I agree with. And this is, you know, the fact that at a certain point, desire is embraced as the expansion of the self is what the poem maintains in the next two cantos, and it is also what the poem pushes in the Paradiso. But here, the emphasis is different. Here, the emphasis, in Purgatorio 16, the emphasis is placed rather on the necessity of laws and the consequences when they are not enforced. Thus, Marco can conclude his speech with the claim that the reason that the world is going astray is to be attributed not to humankind's corrupt nature, the remedy for which is indeed meant to be provided by the laws, but to the bad guidance offered by the papacy. ben puoi vedere che la mala condotta è la cagion che il mondo ha fatto reo, e non natura che in voi sia corrotta. The rest of Marco's speech is dedicated to stressing the contrast between past and present in a way that recalls Inferno and Paradiso 16, but also specifies that the fault is to be attributed to the Pope and its interference in the into the leadership of the worldly sphere, which should instead belong uniquely to the Emperor. And here is one of the moments where also Dante sort of loses it a little bit, because, you know, he insists so much on this point. And if there is indeed one main point to Dante's political thought, both in the Divine Comedy and in the Monarchia, it is that Emperor and Pope should act into completely separate spheres without any mutual interference, the former devoted to the pursuit of the happiness of humankind on earth, and the latter in the afterlife. So, and I would say that the second part, this last part of Marco's speech, goes back to the contrast between the past and the present, which was characterizing also the other 16 cantos. So the first contrast made by Marco Lombardo between the past and the present is the famous image of the two sons that remained separated in ancient Rome, while now one, the Pope, has obscured the other, the Emperor. As I was saying, it's always the same sort of like recurrent motif. Soleva Roma che il buon mondo feo due soli aver, che l'una e l'altra strada facean vedere, e del mondo e di Deo. L'un l'altro ha spento. The Pope has, I don't know how to say, spento the empire. Ed è giunta la spada col pastorale, e l'un con l'altro insieme, per viva forza mal convien che vada. Però che giunti l'un l'altro non teme, se non mi credi, pon menti alla spiga, ogni erba si conosce per lo seme. So this is the first contrast between the past and the present. In ancient Rome, there were two separate spheres, now the papacy has taken over. The second contrast between the past and the present focuses instead on Northern Italy and on the same virtues of valore e cortesia mentioned in Inferno 16 and taken as the symbol of a world that disappeared. So what comes back is the same phrase, valore e cortesia, that we had seen in Inferno 16. In sul paese Cadice e poi Riga solea valore e cortesia trovarsi prima che Federico avesse la briga. Federico II, the Holy Sacred Emperor. Or poi sicuramente indi passarsi per qualunque lasciasse, per vergogna di ragionar coi buoni o d'appressarsi. Ben ve tre vecchi ancora in cui rampogna l'antica età la nova, e parlo tardo che Dio a miglior vita li ripogna. I find this passage interesting for two reasons. The first one is that the reference to the three old men. There are just three just men. The reference to the three old men who offer a rebuke to the modern times recalls the three Florentine sodomites of Inferno 16, and makes clear a contrast between three truly honest men and the Florentine leaders, whose portrayed ambivalence now reveals its limits, and who appear, especially after also reading Paradiso 16's celebration of the remote past, as very much part of that factional world of civic strife and personal interest that characterizes the political scene of Florence in the second part of the 13th century. And, as Simon Gilson has argued, the words valore cortesia, which were used by the sodomites as symbolic of what has been lost in the present, return here, but, I quote, are now set within a broader context of individual and institutional responsibility. So, like, while in a certain way one could think, that, according to the standpoint in the Commedia, the political situation in Italy and Europe was ill-governed thanks to the fight between papacy and empire, and that therefore the Florentine leaders were themselves misguided, it is also clear that they are responsible for their actions and for being, in their turn, misguiding leaders. And if we consider that what the Florentine politicians share with Brunetto and possibly with the other sodomite teachers and grammarians presented in the previous canto is an obsession with fame, which was presented by Brunetto as the means for gaining eternal life, poi mi insegnaste come l'uomo eterna, I wonder whether it is possible to think of the sin of sodomy as violating the natural desire to return to God through the misguidance of the desires of their pupils or their citizens, respectively. The fact that the sodomites are respected by the pilgrim and by the Florence in which he grew up would not so much show that their Florence was better, but rather would demonstrate their corrupting power, their success in convincing people that it is by focusing on fame that one achieves immortality. And the second point that I would make, one of the reasons why I thought that this passage was interesting, and the second point that I want to make, and here I would really draw some final remarks, is the line prima che Federigo avesse briga, because this line refers once more to the war between the emperor and the pope, and is meant to stress once again that the pope's greed has been and still is responsible for the decadence of Italy, as it's emphasized again a few lines afterwards. Di oggi mai che la Chiesa di Roma, per confondere in sé due reggimenti, cade nel fango e se brutta e la soma. So, the bad leadership of the Pope and to some extent of the Emperor is responsible for the current degeneracy of human affairs. And yet, one shouldn't conclude that the Pope has replaced the stars in bearing responsibility for man's behavior. As Marco Lombardo has also made it clear, each individual is and remains fully responsible for their own actions, independently, that is, from the conditions that the Emperor or the Pope have created for them. And this is precisely why the Florentine sodomites are punished in hell. In other words, and this is really the final point that I would like to make today, I think that it is possible to spot another tension in the Divine Comedy between stressing the individual's full responsibility for what they do on earth and what they get in the afterlife, and highlighting the importance of the political context and the weight that it bears on them, as is made clear not only in each of the 16 cantos, but also by all the attention that the poem gives to politics and to the way in which it is handled. If this attention to politics is a certainly a symptom that the poem, albeit eschatological, is indeed written, as Erika Auerbach said already in 1919, by a Dichter der irdischen Welt, a poet of the terrestrial world, of the world on earth, it is also a sign that, as is also clear from the Monarchia, when Dante deals with politics, he is more interested in showing its effects on men rather than their full autonomy. In these cases, Dante's vision of humankind is bleaker, and this is when one can still feel the wound of the exile. If, as scholars have shown, the last cantos of the poem stage the pilgrim's progressive detachment from Florence, finally replaced by the entrance into the community of the heaven Jerusalem, I wonder whether the nostalgia for the past, so prominent in the cantos that I've read today, remind us, in fact, to what extent the poet continues to be affected by the thoughts and memories of its city. Thank you.